Hello, welcome to Project Mosaic. We're here in London at the office of Fayez Magal. Fayez, thank you for meeting with me.
Thank you.
You run an organization that you set up yourself called Faith Matters. Could you tell me what Faith Matters does and how you got into that?
Absolutely. We do four pieces of, four themes of work. Well, primarily, the organization started off with Muslim-Jewish dialogue. That started off in 2002, doing that work. And we've moved on from doing interfaith work to community cohesion work, now possibly called integration work. We also do preventing extremism work and conflict resolution. So four themes of work. But the starting base of the organization was around Muslim-Jewish dialogue approximately 9 years ago.
That's a lot to be involved in. Also, you have served in local government as a councillor in London and also in Oxford. And after the July 7, 2005 bombings in London, you were part of a working group that was trying to get to the bottom of radicalization of young people. Are we making progress in the UK on that front?
I think there's been significant progress made in terms of radicalization, and I think also the message has gone from the Al-Qaeda-inspired extremism to including elements of far-right extremism, but also other faith-based extremism that's present. So what we've done is we've taken and we've made significant strides on the Al-Qaeda-inspired extremism and violent extremism element, but also made it very clear that extremism in general in our society will not be tolerated, and that we as a liberal, small L society will always stand up to ensure that people mix, get together, understand one another's perspectives, but also counter those who try to divide. So I think there's been significant investment. I think there's been significant headway. I think there is a sense that actually some of the violent extremist narratives just are not acceptable in communities. And I think there's a feeling, particularly of young people now from all faith communities and others who don't profess to be your faith communities, of actually trying to come together to do good in their areas. And that means social activity has burgeoned. It means that young individuals from Muslim communities are starting to feel more confident in the work they do. But also there isn't a feeling of complete stigmatization within some faith communities, and in fact they're starting to link up and join up and learn from each other, and that also is a very positive way forward. So yes, there has been significant strides forward, but in this agenda, hate has a way to transform and mutate itself, and it really is about keeping the eye on the ball and keeping the focus of social activity around tracking it, understanding it, looking at the phenomena that cause it, and also trying to help those who get caught up within the concept of hating or feeling that they have no part in society.
Could I ask you a question about identity? You are British. Your family lived for three generations in Uganda. You were 11 when you arrived in the UK from Africa, and originally your ancestors were from India. You're Muslim. Do these multiple identities help or hinder you in your work?
Multiple identities are an extremely healthy thing. They don't hinder me with my work. They have kept me, I think, very grounded. They have made me feel over time that I'm a part of this country and this country is a part of me. They have made me in my work have an empathy or develop empathies with different communities and be able to develop empathies with people, and that's very important. And the multiple identities also save me, if I use that term, save me from taking a very brittle approach in life, a mentally brittle approach that unfortunately some people find themselves in. You see, as a person who was born in Africa, I have an affiliation to being a minority within Africa, and that means being able to work with, deal with, work and understand other communities as a minority. It means learning skills that will see me succeed when there is a larger majority and I am a minority. Coming to the UK meant I had to learn new cultures. I had to learn a different way of adapting within a new environment. It meant over time I had to understand what was good in society that I could value and which bits I didn't want to take on board personally. And it also made me traveling and also the identity which carries me to different countries meant that I could also value what was good in the UK and also hold that close to me and not take it for granted. And it is all of these elements that I think have developed me into an individual who can cope with severe stress in terms of changes of my own environment, It can make me deal with people of different faiths, different cultures, different backgrounds. It can make me work with, empathize with people who may be of different sexuality than me. It makes me feel that actually people are, in the end, individuals just like me, and to be able to relate to them in a very straightforward and sometimes a very open manner. And I think there's a healthy elements of me living my life, rather than taking a very brittle approach that saying possibly some people say, I'm British, and British means being this. Well, it doesn't mean being just a pigeonholed element, or saying, I'm Muslim, I'm this. Or some people may say, I'm Christian and I'm this. Well, we are all multiple identities, and we always will be. And as life and communication gets faster and more varied, we will become we will have more elements to who we are in the future. And so those that take a very, very brittle approach need to take a hard and fast look at who and where they're going, who they are and where they're going in society. Because those individuals, I think, will not be as successful in the future in a globalized environment.
I'd like to ask if we could talk about the event at which we met several months ago. You were giving a talk at the West London Synagogue, and it was a fascinating talk about a group of individuals you described as righteous Muslims. The gathering at the synagogue, I'm a Roman Catholic, I think I was one of the few non-Jews in the gathering there listening to you. And the individuals you were describing, who in fact were are the subject of this pamphlet that your organization put out, were Muslims who in World War II saved Jews and risked their lives to do so. I wanted to ask whether that gathering at the synagogue that day, a type of gathering one might call a Muslim-Jewish encounter, is something that is happening more at the present time, or is that something that you would have seen 20 years ago in London in the same way, with the same frequency?
I think it's happening far more now over the last 5 years, actually. I think there's been an exponential rise in the number of activities like this between Muslim and Jewish communities, in synagogues, in mosques. So I think that this will continue to grow. I think over the next 5, 10 years, in the next 10 years, it will become part of the norm of activities in the interfaith and in the community cohesion world. And I think what we are seeing is both communities to some degree realizing that more work has to be done to engage with each other. And that the Middle East doesn't have to be the kind of the bit or the elephant in the room that's really never discussed. And I think that's some really groundbreaking work is being done between both faith communities, where I think more exchange of individuals within mosques, so Jews going to mosques, Muslims going to synagogues, will continue. It'll become part of the fabric of work. And in the next 10 years, we won't see it as being anything other than the norm. So we're in the positive direction, in my opinion.
Could we come back for a moment to the subject of radicalization? If we think back to the bombings on July 7, 2005, or the many suicide bombings that have taken place in lots of different countries in the last several years, is there something that ordinary people can do to help prevent the radicalization of young people?
I think there is something that families can do. Let's start off with this. Even if it's people who are caring for other young people, I think we should take time to try to communicate with young people and understand even our own sons and daughters and the traumas and the pressures they're under today. Because I can tell you that parents whose children have been involved in suicide bombing will more likely say, we never knew that he, and it's mainly a he, and sometimes a she, was going to do such a thing. We didn't have a clue that there was anything, behaviorally that they did, which was untoward, that was different. We didn't even know that they were meeting with different people. And actually what that tells me, and I think it, what it says to society, is that the parents were not really engaged with the young people, didn't know them, didn't feel them, and didn't feel when things were wrong. And I think there's a big lesson, and that means engage more, understand more, communicate more, and build trust with your own families and children. Because really, that's the biggest thing that comes out. In every plot, the parents go, "We just didn't know." And there's, I think, a responsibility for all of us to know and try to know what our children or young people are doing.
So there's a role for government. There's a role for the police. It is important to have the right legislation in place. But you're saying the key is get down to the building block of society, the family, the most basic unit in every society.
Correct. And I think there's enough legislation. We don't need more laws upon laws upon laws. I think it comes down to the family units. And I think it also comes down to the way we engage with young people in our society. And the family unit, or the unit involving people who are caring for young people, extremely important. That's where we can capture issues and capture them early and work with people so they don't end up dead, or they don't end up in prison, or they don't end up killing somebody else, but actually they end up doing something productive in society. And that's where the real difference can be made.
Faiz Magal, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Goodbye.